So today we have new information on Avengers Age of Ultron, and it isn't coming from a trailer, and it isn't coming from a featurette. It's not even coming from a magazine article. No, instead it's coming from a series of decals that have been released in advance of the film, and they're quite revealing in terms of the souped-up uniforms and, to some degree, weapons that our core team of Avengers are getting. We have a series of decals here we're going to go through for each core Avenger and Ultron, and again, as I said, some of them are quite revealing in changes for said character. But before we go character by character, I just want to say that the overall impression that this has given me, at least, is that it reminds me of when a toy company has a second round of action figures. And they're like, well, how can we differentiate the second round from the first round? Because we really want to make sure people buy this even though they have the first round of toys. And we're essentially asking them to buy the same character again. And I guess they're thinking of that with this movie because, of course, they sell a lot of Avengers toys, correct? And statuettes, etc., t-shirts. You know, how do you differentiate the all of these toys from the first movie, right? Why can't someone say, well, I'm just going to wear my Avengers t-shirt from the first film. Why do I need a new one? Well, let me tell you, all the costumes are going to be wrong on that first t-shirt. So you need a new one. And that's where Disney and Marvel get you. But it's not as bad as like when they say, oh, you know, Snow Batman, and he's like dressed all in white. And you're like, I've never seen Snow Batman in the comic. And the toy company's like, oh, well, you know, you might. And maybe you would like to have Snow Batman personally. Whatever, leave us alone. We need to sell more toys. So it's not at that level. But I think in a somewhat humorous, you know, nostalgic way, it does remind me of that kind of branding. And that branding, though, is indicative of having too many bells and whistles that just kind of seem a little silly. And some of these characters do border on that, I think, with their new costumes, but hopefully once we see them in action, that won't be the case. So we're going to start off with Black Widow, who I think really needs some help in terms of getting credibility. I think she took a major hit from, of all people, Seth MacFarlane with that Family Guy joke from a few weeks ago, where they had one of their famous cutaways on the show, and it was the Avengers team telling Black Widow, hey, you know what? You don't really have any superpowers, so we don't need you on this team, because the only thing you can do is kick. And then, of course, Seth MacFarlane did pick up on the bond between Black Widow and Hulk with that joke. And even though Black Widow fans like myself are like, that's not true, Black Widow has plenty to offer. It wouldn't have gotten a laugh, and even I chuckled at it, if it wasn't to some degree true. And I think that Joss Whedon also must realize that because he has literally juiced up the character. So here's a shot of her. You can see the page of decals. And right away you notice her batons, or screamasticks. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. But that's, of course, what Nightwing is famous for carrying. And that's very cool. That character has made those screamasticks awesome. I think instantly recognizable to any comic book fan. And they, if they're used correctly, they can be really visually cool as well, even in something that's not static like a comic book image, but on a TV show or a movie. Now, even better, Black Widow's glow, and I think that's really cool. I think that could look really awesome, and this is a little bit like Tron Legacy, and Tron Legacy had amazing visuals, just never delivered on story or ideas, concept ideas. Hopefully, you know, this will be the whole package. Now, of course, we can also see the electricity running through her suit that we saw in the Comic-Con poster when that was that came out, the one you had to piece together. We knew that she was going to have souped-up Widow Sting bracelets. She used those in Captain America the Winter Soldier, but she's never really used them. She only uses them like once. She doesn't, or once or twice. She doesn't use them very often, and I think that's what's led to people saying the character can only kick. I mean, sometimes she fights with the mind, and she's the one who's willing to do things maybe you shouldn't. As I like to say, her superpower is that she has the weakest moral center, or the one that is, you know, the most open to change and reinterpretation, if you want to put it in a positive way. But, so we knew that electricity was going to be built up here. I think running through the whole suit, it probably can go off in other areas, perhaps like her knee pads. I think that that's an interesting addition. I have to say, though, that the knee pads so far don't look particularly flattering. We'll see how they show up in the movie. I think they are doing her any favors in particular on that bottom pose, although that's just not a very flattering pose in general. And, you know, and this is something, you know, it comes up maybe more often for female characters, but any character. Everyone wants to look good in their superhero outfit, right? But I think the nice thing about the knee pads is that it's, and besides maybe she'll be able to deliver electric blows with, you know, and that kind of, just imagine how her fighting stance could evolve if she can deliver electric shocks, not only with her wrists, but her knees. I think that's really interesting as well. So it also is, I think, a very big change for female characters to have them go in a direction where you're thinking of the utility of the design of the suit as opposed to the sex appeal or just how it looks. You'll also notice that even though I think that in the movie, they have platform high heels built into her uniform. Here she's being depicted with flat shoes, which is also a great change. For quite a long time, especially at the beginning of comic book movies, all the female superheroes were in heels. And, you know, even though in real life, if you pay attention, whenever there's a running scene, often in an action movie, any action movie, the actress will slip into flats and, you know, they just hope you don't notice. I remember that particular in a Transformers movie with Rosie Huntington Whitley. But anyway, I think this looks really good. I think it gives her a lot more abilities, and not only in fights, but I think it gives her a little more credibility as someone who can run with the Avengers. So, but I'm curious to what you guys think. Are you like, she didn't need any help? She was fine the way she was? And what do you think of these batons? I think they look great and could give her quite a memorable action sequence, especially if she were to fight in the dark or a dark-ish area. I think that could just be really phenomenal. I'm very excited to see this, and also how her fighting style will evolve with the neat electrified knees. Great, great, great choice. All right, so that's the first set of decals. Now let's move over to Thor, who also, as you can see, has been souped up. Now, we saw in the second trailer, really trailer 1.5, he was channeling some pretty awesome lightning. And that seems to be something that they're really playing off here in this decal. Oh, by the way, you know, just on a side note, sometimes they soup up the decals and it's not actually included in the movie. So we'll see if this is something that is included in the movie. But it looks like, as you can see, Mjolnir is electrified. And so I guess he and Black Widow can share lightning or energy together, right? But he's really having that being brought on as more of a motif for himself as well. They could feel with how his films have been somewhat underperforming that Thor perhaps is in need of a little more oomph, a little more pizzazz visually, and I think lightning is certainly the way to go. So you not only see it in Mjolnir, but of course that awesome Avengers electrified A that's in his corner. That looks fantastic. That looks really good. And I think they have to establish this before Shazam shows up on the scene, right, over at DC, because he's a big lightning-based character as well. And they're like, whoa, if we're not careful, everyone's going to think Thor's copying Shazam. You know, I don't know off the top of my head which character actually came first in the comics, but you know, it's right now it's a race for who can establish this kind of lightning persona on the big screen. So otherwise, the costume seems pretty on target the way he's usually looked. I like the addition of the purple there on the undercoat with his his vest there. I like the cape, always looks good. Thor rocks a good cape in my opinion, and I also they continue to have the scientific space elements to the costume. You know, kind of moving towards the Asgard as being an advanced race in terms of technology rather than the more mythological direction that the character had gone in the comics for so long. But the big change here is the electricity. Then next we've got a really good look at Vision. Now, speaking of capes, this is the only other member of the team to wear a cape, and one has to wonder why an android would want to put on a cape. Maybe he looks at Thor and says, I like what I see. But you can see a little more detail here in the design of the cape, and that the motif that is through the costume of perhaps, a computer grid is carried into the cape. So that's, I think, very nice. I think that ties the character more together. You see the costume a little more. You see a little more detail on the head here. Again, I like that this is like a kind of like a fabric that seems to be stretched over an exoskeleton, a metal exoskeleton. Because, of course, Vision is an android. He's not flesh and blood. So he's just, all those muscles there, he just built on himself. Or, the science bros did, because, the rumor is they're the ones who create the Vision. So here you see also a little bit in that small motif there and that decal. You see again carrying through the theme of computer graphics and channels. And so expect to see Vision. I still believe, as I discussed before in my episode talking about when the Vision is going to show up, that he's going to be a character who is used towards the end of the film to really fight Ultron toe-to-toe, or computer to computer, so to speak. So this is just a really good look at that character and the boots and everything. And there, I think I have to applaud the design team on these costumes for having a similarity in the aesthetics and, the way the boots are done. They're all kind of like on the same level. DC tried to do that over with the New 52, but, this is a team, even here though, these are teams that come up with their costumes independently, right? Unless someone at S.H.I.E.L.D., they have their own, Edna Mode designing all these costumes for them. But, still, they haven't established in any of these cinematic universes a source for the costumes. And if they're all doing this on their own, they should look different, right? But, it ties the team together visually. Then Hawkeye, Jeremy Renner, finally getting some attention. They're really selling this coat, which I think is awesome. I think this is a great trench coat. I think it's a cool look for the character. It keeps his look from the first film. But again, they have to soup it up because you need new merchandise. If they don't do this, you're going to be like, I'll just wear my old Avengers t-shirt. And you can't. So you see this with the target motif put in here a little bit, but still not as much as some of the other characters. I think you can tell by who has the most decals, kind of who's going to be really important in the movie and who they think people are going to want to purchase a lot of decals for. So that looks cool. And it, basically the only change here is the trench. But I like it. Also, I think it's interesting they did away with his shades. But I think that's a good idea because, you know, as James Marsden so famously said, it's almost impossible to relate to the audience if your eyes are covered. And to really portray character. You can't not only connect, but you, there's not much you can do, period. So very cool there as well. All right, then we have Captain America. This is his new costume. He's put the Avengers A on his arms there. I guess, you know, this is an organization he feels a little bit better about being a part of after his blow up with S.H.I.E.L.D. and Winter Soldier. I like that it I still think he should lose the helmet. I don't see why he needs it. It doesn't look like it provides any real protection for his head. And they always just have to find ways for it to come off, right? I just think it doesn't work out so well. I love the decal of the S.H.I.E.L.D. embedded in the wall. I think that's super awesome. As I've said before, Winter Soldier finally sold me on the S.H.I.E.L.D. and how it's actually useful in the field of battle. But I do like that a lot of World War II elements are carried over here because, you know, that's his fashion sense. You know, he's like, I still like it. You know, the boots, for instance, are very World War II. It's very, you know, indicative of that kind of style that you saw in a lot of soldiers' uniforms back then. And just the brown leather in general. It's something you don't see a lot. But I think it looks really cool and it ties the character into his history. So, again, I like this. I would just lose that mask. He has knee pads as well, but they're built in more to the costume. So Hawkeye, yeah, they actually all have knee pads except for Vision. But I think that Black Widows are the ones that are electrified. All right, then the Hulk. And again, here, you know, that they haven't done that much with this character, but the cool thing is that he has expanding pants. I think you can see the pants there. They have a lot of different grooves in there. So it seems that he's talked to them about what happened to him in the first film, and he's like, you know, I had to scrounge around for pants and talk to a very nice janitor. So if there's any way that maybe we could work on that, I would appreciate it. So it looks like the Science Bros invented some new pants for him, and I like the purple, and it looks almost like a, you know, purple, obviously, because that's the famous color for the character, but some red detailing on there as well. Very, very S.H.I.E.L.D., very Hawkeye a little bit. You know, it would be interesting if Hulk kind of fell in with that group, I've made them into a celebrity couple, Black Widow and Hawkeye. All right, so then, interestingly, you have, now, Iron Man comes in here, and he has the least decals. I think because he's had so many movies and been so popular for so long that there just is only so much you can do with the character. But he has, to make up for it, he has two pages, because there's another character that gets, version of him that gets a whole page for itself. But this, I think, looks a little more streamlined. I like that. I'd be interested to know why he still has the core reactor. I believe I guess it powers the suit, but they found a way, of course, at the end of the movie that he no longer needed that. But I think that, you know, more gold, and it's getting harder and harder to tell each Iron Man or each, you know, mock version apart, right? And that's supposed to be a big selling point. Like, collect all of the mock versions, Mach 5, Mach 4, etc. This looks, you know, I'm personally having a hard time telling them all apart. But then the second page goes to the Hulkbuster. This is apparently going to be a big fight in the movie. They think this is going to really be the, you know, the standout action sequence. There's a ton of stuff already publicized this, so it gets, of course, its own page. Now, I can tell this one apart from the other costume, obviously, and so I think that it's interesting that they're playing this up so much. But it is a very cool uniform. Although I always wonder with this and a lot of the mech suits, you know, that we see, like the Jaeger suits, I don't understand how you can really control a robot when you are, you know, it's so removed from you, right? I mean, it's not really an extension of your arm because it's so far from where your arm actually is. I would feel that it would be, you know, you're so removed from the fight. I think it would be difficult to control it. But, you know, that's, I think, a question that isn't particularly fun, and I think we're all just going to go along with the fantasy of it. But it's a great uniform. It's a great Iron Man suit, and I can see why it's getting so much attention. You would think, by the way, you'd have more reactors to power something this big. Be like, I need like three of these. All right, then finally we've got Ultron. Ultron here, this is a great, you know, full body shot of the character. He's kind of got like metal underpants going on there, as you can see. But I really love the design. I think Ultron is a very good designer because, of course, he designs himself out of an old Iron Man suit. So this is actually like mock Ultron. I love the red energy pulsing through him. You know, he has those energy beams that we also saw teased in the 1.5 trailer. And I think there's just the... I really do feel, as I've said before, that this is a character who's finally going to provide a really strong villain for the Avengers. And I think that Marvel and Disney must feel that way as well, because they think it's really going to catch on, and this is something people are going to be interested in. And so I'll be curious to see who maybe sides with Ultron over the Avengers and says, I want that merchandise. Then also you can see there's this fun little logo on the bottom. It's almost animated with all the characters and Ultron there. Right in the middle there with his red glowing eyes. All right, so those are the characters that got decals. I'm curious to know what you guys think of these reveals. And also, what do you think of the fact that Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch did not get decals? I think that alone maybe hints at them having reduced roles in the actual film, which, you know, makes sense. There's only so much room in this movie for everybody. It can't be like a 3 to 4 hour opus, although that would be awesome. But the fact that they don't think those characters warrant decals, I think, shows that they might only be in one or two scenes. We'll see what happens, though. We'll see. All right, so that's my coverage of this. I'm looking forward to discussing with you in the comments down below, and you can check out some other episodes right now.